Good afternoon and welcome to Today on BTV. We are live in Swansea on Thursday 11th May 2017. I'm Liz Cairns, this is Gaynor Morgan, and with us is Robert Llewelyn-Jones and Craig Lawton, Conservative 2017 general election candidate for Swansea West.
But before we kick things off, shall we hear some music with OJ Lewis?
Shot of cocaine and I shot my woman down. Went right home and I went to bed. I stuck that loving 44 beneath my head. Got up next morning and I grabbed that gun. Took a shot of cocaine and away I did run. Made a good run, but I run too slow. They overtook me down in Juarez, Mexico. Laid in the hot joints, taking the pills. In walked the sheriff from Jericho Hill. He said, Willie, your name is not Jack Brown, and you're the dirty hack that shot your woman down. Said, yes, oh yes, my name is Willie. If you got a warrant, boy, just read it to me. Shot her down because she made me slow. I thought it was her daddy, but she had five more. When I was arrested, I was dressed in black. They put me on a train and they took me back. Had no friend for to go my bail. They sat my dried up carcass in a county jail. Early next morning, about a half past nine, I spied a little sheriff coming down the line. Up then he coughed as he cleared his throat. He said, come on, you dirty hack, into that district court. Into that courtroom my trial began, where I was handled by 12 honest men. Just before the jury started out, I saw that little judge commence to look about. In about 5 minutes in walked the man, holding the verdict in his right hand. The verdict read in the first degree. I hollered, Lordy, Lordy, have mercy on me. The judges smiled as he picked up his pen. 99 years in the San Quentin pen. 99 years underneath that ground. I can't forget the day I shot my woman down. Come on, you gotta listen on to me. Lay off that whiskey and let that cocaine be.
Ooh, what a way to start the show. It's a job to come back down to earth.
But, shall we have a look at what happened on this day in history?
Yes, there's been so much. In 1969, the most famous Monty Python comedy troupe was formed. And as we know, Monty Python is also known as the Pythons. We had a British surreal comedy group who created the sketch comedy show Monty Python's Flying Circus, which first aired on the BBC in 1969. Now we have a nice video clip. Should we watch it?
Just to cheer it up.
Yes.
Who are you?
We are the Knights Who Say...
No, not the Knights Who Say Nay.
The same.
Who are they?
We are the keepers of the sacred words. Ni, peng, and ni-wum.
Those who hear them seldom live to tell the tale.
The Knights Who Say Ni demand a sacrifice.
Knights of Ni, we are but simple travelers who seek the enchanter who lives beyond these woods.
Ni, 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 we shall say ni again to you if you do not appease us.
Well, what is it you want?
We want a shrubbery.
Enriching your life.
Shall I say it, or will you now for something completely different?
Robert Llewelyn-Jones, the master of the pity phrase. Craig Lawton, are you a fan?
Oh, massively. It's amazing, really, because I think, realistically, anyone my age, anyone younger than me, should really think of Michael Palin for traveling around the world, and anyone now who looks at him would think, wow, what's he doing there? But led to so many other things, led to obviously Fawlty Towers, which obviously then influenced Blackadder, and just all, you know, lots of modern comedy wouldn't have without it.
Are you a fan, Robert?
Of? Palin, please. Well, yes, I enjoyed them very much, and I still look forward to the repeats. You know, when they come around, and some of the sketches, the dead parrot for it will always be with us, and I think one or two others as well. And
timeless classic,
yes,
definitely.
And of course, we forget that it was a Welshman who was head of BBC at the time who gave them the opportunity.
And he was is.
Well, it was Hugh Wilden, I believe.
All right. Something new. That's brilliant. Right, also, in 1981, sadly, as we all know, Bob Marley died. We have an amazing clip of him. Watch him first and then speak about him.
Have you made a lot of money out of your music?
Money? I mean, how much is a lot of money to you?
Yeah, that's a good question. Have you made, say, millions of dollars?
No.
Are you a rich man?
What do you mean rich? What do you mean?
Do you have a lot of possessions? A lot of money in the bank?
Position make you rich? I don't have that type of richness. My richness is life, forever.
So the, iconic.
Yeah, the really sad thing is apparently he had a malignant melanoma under his toenail.
Yeah.
And he refused the doctor's advice, didn't he, to have his... toe off.
Yeah, it's for religious reasons.
Was it?
Yeah. And also, it would have impeded on his, well, his music career, and that's what, also why.
Not a good decision.
There we are then.
No.
There we are.
I know. In, it was 1977, actually, that they found the malignant melanoma. But a lot of people have thought it was due to, primarily because of the injury during his football. But it wasn't. It was the underlying cancer he'd already had, and that's what it was for. But, sadly, after his health did deteriorate with the cancer and spread throughout then his body, the rest of the tour was cancelled because he was determined at some point to continue the tour. But sadly,
it keeps people going, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Keeps people going.
Yeah. The man's iconic. Everybody, all ages.
Yeah.
All ages know him.
Yeah,
wasn't the great hit in The Prince of Wales, but that's another story.
Yeah. Right. Also, in 1960, the first contraceptive pill was made.
As long ago as that. Changed history, didn't it? Revolutioned women's lives.
Yes.
Well, definitely. It cut down on things as well, didn't it?
I suppose it's done something to help the population.
Yes, definitely. The Food and Drug Administration approved it. Commercially, it was originally called the Envoy 10. Now we all know it as the pill. And in the early 1950s, Gregory Pincus, a biochemist at the Worcester Foundation for Experimental Biology, and John Rock, a gynaecologist at Harvard Medical School, they are the ones that began the work on the contraceptive pill. And it's still
literally going
to change
the world.
It was a revolution, wasn't it?
Definitely.
A social revolution sparked by that.
Yeah.
Revolutionised women's lives.
Well, I'm sure it did, then, I'm sure, yes. I mean, prior to that, they'd been taking Smarties in the belief.
And did that work, Robert?
Well, there was a famous rugby player who was something of a hypochondriac. He used to complain before he went on to play that he had a headache and goodness knows what. And the trainer would say, well, now look, take one of these. And you'll feel better. And he would give him a little pill and he would run on and it was wonderful. He never found out that he was taking Smarties. That's what they were giving him. And
he thought it was the contraceptive pill.
No, not the contraceptive pill. No.
But they blew Smarties. Give him the energy.
There is a suggestion.
Ray Gravel, that was.
Was it Ray Gravel?
Ray Gravel.
Oh, well, he was a darling, wasn't he? Absolute darling. Well, there we go.
I was quite shocked with this one. In 1812, the waltz was introduced into British ballrooms.
The waltz?
The waltz.
Oh, right, the waltz. Can you waltz, darling?
Of course.
But what I was surprised about was the fact that observers considered it disgusting and immoral.
Oh, right.
Really?
Well, our studio manager, Jeff, is a prize-winning
at the court of the Prince Regent, that wouldn't constitute immorality. so much else did.
I'm just wondering what they think of the new dances now, that's out.
There we go.
are they dances now, are they?
Enough.
Thank you. Well, after the break, we'll be looking at today's papers with Robert Llewellyn Jones. Welcome back to Today on Bay TV. I'm Liz Cairns and this is Gaynor Morgan and Robert Llewellyn-Jones. And also with us is Craig Loughton, the Conservative 2017 general election candidate for Swansea West.
But before we dive into the papers, Bay TV's head of news, Carolyn Evans, was in Cardiff this morning with Lib Dem leader Tim Farron. Let's have a look at what was said.
Who says that Britain must now struggle under the yoke of a one-party state led by Theresa May? Who says that our farmers, that our small business people must pay huge exorbitant export tariffs as we're outside the single market? Who says we must see dwindling public services? Who says we must be the kind of country that slams the door on desperate refugees? Who says that's the country we inherit and live, allow our children to inherit after us? I say it is time for some hope. I say Britain can be a better place than the place Theresa May envisages it will be. That is why we here in Wales announced today that we will give the go-ahead right now to the Swansea Tidal Lagoon and that we will set in train tidal lagoons in Cardiff, in Colwyn Bay, in other parts of this great country and right across the United Kingdom.
There we are, Tim Farron. Craig, who says rather dismal...
Oh, well, where to start? He talks about support for small businesses. Well, the Conservatives are giving lots of support for small businesses. If you look at England, we've made sure that all businesses with a rateable relief of less than £15,000, so that's lots of small high street businesses that can maybe employ one extra person and really add to the economy. We've given them all a rebate on business rates. We've called for the same in Wales. Obviously, that's devolved. Carwyn Jones and Welsh Labour, they've refused to do that. They've only gone to 12,000. So you have businesses here, say in Uplands or in Sketty, that are not on a fair level playing field compared to those in England. So I'd like to think we are doing that, and it's trying to push for that here as well.
It's all very well as long as you've got the money coming in, but come Brexit, will we have the money coming in? The economy is already, this morning, according to reports from the Bank of England, not growing as fast as was forecast.
Yeah, I think there's plenty of opportunities as we leave and after we leave the European Union. You only have to look at the fact that Theresa May was here about 6-7 weeks ago to sign the city deal for Swansea, worth 1.3.
The Lib Dems say that they give the go-ahead to the lagoon. We haven't heard that yet.
I'm 100% behind the lagoon. I've met with Tidal Lagoon many times.
But
we've looked at it. I'm 100% behind it. I want to see it happen. The issue we've got is we need to make sure that the strike price, so the cost of the fuel, is right. So we don't just get green fuel, we also get fuel that is good value for people in their homes. The difficulty we've got is that if you look at the Assembly and the Welsh Government, they've refused to give the licence yet. We could have had that 2 years ago. So even if the UK government were to say, yes, we'll go ahead with this, we've got the price right, they can't start building yet. We're hearing reports that it might be June 2018. Natural Resources Wales, which comes under the Welsh Government, haven't given it that licence. They could have given it 2 years ago.
Bought you a bit of time.
They're holding it back.
What do you think, Robert?
Well, I'd love to see the lagoon, of course. I agree with Craig, and I know that you're sympathetic towards it. I saw Sharrock Saturday in Llanelli and had a chat with him, and I'm rather hoping...
Sharrock?
He's the chief executive of Mark Sharrock, and I'm hoping that he'll come here and sit on the sofa with us and tell us all about it, yes.
So the Conservative pledges, is it difficult to get them across?
In what way?
Well, do you find that people in Wales are receptive?
Yeah, I think if you, out on the doorstep, and actually people have been coming up to me, talking to me, we've had people emailing me in the last couple of days. Before I was actually announced as the candidate, people saying, how can I vote for the Conservatives? Can I help? Which, is a fantastic situation. I was up till 1 o'clock responding to emails with people asking if they could have signs, people I've never met before. So, yeah, definitely, I think people want to see that strong leadership from Theresa May here.
Yes, I was going to say, with regards to emails, and I'm sure Jeremy Corbyn's had quite a few, going by all the papers, Telegraph, it's been on the headlines of every single newspaper, with the leakage of the Labour's drafted election manifesto. We have a video first we're going to look at. So, what do you think about that, then?
Well, I suppose the question is, what's the real story? Is the story that Jeremy Corbyn is kind of rehashing something that didn't work for Ed Miliband 2 years ago, sort of and adding extra socialism to it, taking us back to the 70s? Or is it that actually some of his own MPs have leaked it in the first place? Arguably, the fact that his own members of Parliament, they don't trust him, they're not behind him, there's no certainty in Labour whatsoever, they felt the need to actually leak this. Arguably, that's a bigger story. I mean, a lot of this stuff in their manifesto, we heard 2 years ago, people didn't go for it then, they went backwards then. They're going to go backwards again.
Great suicide document, wouldn't you say, sir?
Well, he's not put it on the headstone, has he?
I quote Kaufman, who called a previous Labour manifesto the longest... what did he call it? The longest death sentence yet written. And I'm sad to see the state of the Labour Party because we need an effective opposition, Craig, don't we?
Definitely. You know, if you look at the Welsh Assembly, you look at Parliament, you do need that effective opposition. If you look at the Assembly, we have the Welsh Conservatives who are acting as really good opposition, putting forward viable alternatives to Welsh Labour here. But we don't seem to have that in England and for the whole of the UK on non-devolved issues, which is a shame.
Of course, to add insult to injury, really, we've had the story about the involvement of the cameraman and Corbyn's car, wasn't it?
Yeah,
there was an accident this morning. Have we got any footage of that? I think some of the... Yeah. It was. Oh, because there we are. Jeremy Corbyn, when he was arriving for this meeting, his car appears to have run over the cameraman's foot. So... it'd be a bit flippant to say it's a car crash of a story, wouldn't it? But
what else can go wrong for him, I wonder?
There was a bit of an outcry as well this morning. I think it was about 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock. He should have been attending the poster release and he didn't. We haven't got an actual video of it.
That might be connected with this incident.
It could well be now, looking, yes. Mm. At the time, nothing was said of that, but it could well be the connection. But there was a bit of an outcry as to why he wasn't there, and one of the leaders, he walked away and wouldn't answer any questions whatsoever. So that's not really looking good either. So.
Shall we move on? What else have we got in the papers?
We've also got in the Western Mail, Swansea, in the business
It's
part.
A very good story, actually. Have you seen this, Craig?
Which one's
on this? How Swansea is a favourable place for young people to start a business. I don't know whether you saw it in today's edition of the Western Mail, but, you know, we've spoken before we came on air about the universities here in Swansea and how the potential for young people to remain in Swansea with a business, it's a wonderful incentive, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, you look at Swansea University. I went to Swansea University, so I'm a bit biased when I say that it's excellent, but I think others agree as well, and you just have to look at the tables. But having University of Wales, Trinity St David's as well, having two universities not competing, but actually really both adding something to the local economy, both growing. We have the new university campus for Swansea Uni and University of Wales, Trinity St David's. Mm. They have their own as well coming. So, you know, I think it's fantastic. And, you know, we've got to try and now make sure that we get the investment so that we have the opportunities for people to stay and use
those
skills.
What are the other factors to support small businesses that are important?
Well, I think you have innovation has to be rewarded, Gaynor. And the only way you can do that is through the Welsh Assembly government at one level, perhaps the national government at another. What would you
Yeah,
say,
definitely. I'd say there's things that the Welsh government can do, and it's pleasing to see that they've sort of rolled out their apprenticeships to cover all ages now, not just people of a certain age, because there's lots of people, as we have a changing world, people need to retrain, get new skills. And actually, I'm actually a trustee of a charity that does exactly that. We help young people and people out of work get those extra skills, retrain and get the experience to find those new jobs. So it's all about experiences, but inward investment is important as well. I think that's why things like the Lagoon and the City deal are going to be so important.
Thank you both. Thank you so much.
And next, we are staying with Craig Lawton to talk about starting his campaign.
So we look forward to seeing you then. Join us.
welcome back to Today on Bay TV. I'm Liz Cairns and this is Gaynor Morgan. And we're still with Craig Lawton, Conservative 2017 general election candidate for Swansea West.
It's kind of mouthful, isn't it?
I know. Have to get it right.
I'm glad I didn't have to say all that. Where should we start then? What are your prospects? Are you confident?
Yeah, I think there's a good opportunity here. I think what's interesting is that the person that was the MP until we had dissolution of Parliament, they actually refused to vote to have the general election. So I suppose some people would be saying, do they want to actually stand before the electorate and let people have that choice? Which is, you know, an interesting one.
Some people wouldn't be you.
Sorry?
So some people wouldn't be you.
No, well, I'm relishing the opportunity to have have this opportunity now. I stood in Swansea West for the Assembly last year. Yeah. It's an area I know very well. I came here in 2006 for university. I got my first ever job here as well. So, I love the area. I care about it. Not just Swansea West, but the whole city. I'm looking forward to having the opportunity.
There are complications in a sense in that the Conservatives seem to be using the brand of Theresa May rather than Conservative. Is that a problem, do you think?
I don't think it's a complication or a problem. I think, you know, people have got to decide. It's not only who stands up and represents them in Swansea West in Parliament. It's who's going to be the Prime Minister. And, you know, it's a simple decision as far as I'm concerned. Do you want Jeremy Corbyn negotiating with the EU? Do you want Jeremy Corbyn meeting with Nicola Sturgeon or with Donald Trump? Or do you want Theresa May and that stability? And that's a question
that
people are going to be...
That's far too simplistic, surely.
Well, it's the system we have. You know, those are the two options that people have in terms of who's going to be Prime Minister. So, yes, people are going to have to vote for a strong voice that's going to stand up for them in Swansea West and champion the projects that they think are important. But it is also about who's going to be the Prime Minister. As I say, it's that choice between Theresa May or Jeremy Corbyn.
You do ask Conservatives seem to be relying very heavily on brand Theresa May and on the single issue of Brexit. And there's so much more at stake in our society, in our country these days.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think it's a single issue. I think what's interesting is that people want to talk about Brexit. It's the issue that comes up the most when I talk to people.
Do they? Will you look?
I appreciate there are lots of other things, but Brexit is definitely important. But I've got other issues that I really care about, issues that are important just to Swansea that someone else might not know about, and it's not for them to know about. But they are important for Swansea. Things like getting the local development plan right, where are the houses going to be built? Have we got the infrastructure in place for those things? The council at present have delayed that, so we don't know where they're going to build those houses.
It's the Labour administration, isn't it, the council? They've got a pretty good track record, in fairness.
Well, you know, they've increased council tax every year since they came to power in 2012. They've achieved the city deal
and they're working hard. I
give them credit. You know, working with all those local authorities, with Alan Cairns, the Secretary of State for Wales, and with Theresa May, it's been a team effort to bring bring the city region project together. And it's going to be important that all those parts play together.
The people of Swansea could recognise that because I think Swansea didn't have the highest Labour win in the local elections.
Yeah, what's also interesting to note, though, is that we now, I think, very much have a choice in Swansea. If you look at those results, it is Labour or the Conservatives. We doubled our number of councillors. Yes, we went from 4 to 8, but that's an extremely good start. Everywhere that we didn't win, we pretty much came second in. So I'm very pleased with those local
government
results.
Second won't be good enough for you, though, will it?
No, it won't be. You know, we came second last time, though. We overtook the Lib Dems. People see that, you know, the Lib Dems can't achieve anything for them nationally or in Swansea. And now, as I say, it's that choice between Theresa May or Jeremy Corbyn. Who do they want to be negotiating on our behalf?
So what can you achieve for people of Swansea then?
Well, I think I've shown before already that I'm a campaigner. I'll roll my sleeves up. I'll go out and work on the issues that people care about. We were talking about the LDP, that local development plan. I worked with residents from, you know, across the board of all political persuasions and of no political persuasion on the Save the Wreck campaign, which was a really important issue in Uplands and Bryn Mawr.
And what did that involve?
So the Wreck is a piece of land next to St Helens. There's me. looking a bit cold, actually, yeah. There. And Swansea Council initially wanted to include that in the local development plan. It's a piece of land that's been there for hundreds of years.
Where exactly is it?
Right next to the rugby stadium on Oyster Mouth Road, on the front.
So you can see it from Oyster Mouth Road.
Yeah, opposite the 360, the 360 Cafe. Swansea Council wanted to include that in the local development plan. They wanted to have the opportunity to build houses on it at some point.
it's a piece of land that's been important
and it's
for
much
recreation,
cherished, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a people for generations. And we had a campaign to save that, to preferably bring forward a village green so that it would be preserved forever for the community. Swansea Council opposed it. They employed a barrister to actually go forward in the hearing and oppose it.
So you deployed your legal training?
Well, I helped the campaigners as much as I could. You know, they were fantastic. They did so much work. There were people with no legal training at all that were in that courtroom going toe-to-toe with a thousands of pounds barrister. So did fantastic well. It was disappointing. The council didn't allow the village green in the end, so they stopped that. But we did win in a way that the council took the rec out of the local development plan. So they won't be building on it in this tranche of planned building. My concern, however, is if you weren't going to build on it, Swansea Council, why not let a village green happen? Why not let it become a village green? The question mark is, are they preserving it to be able to build on it at some time in the future? I don't want to see that, and local campaigners don't. So that's just one example of something I've done
locally. What are some of the other issues you've been involved in?
So I'm really passionate about working with disability charities. I'm a trustee of two charities local to Swansea. I've met with groups from Alzheimer's Society, National Autism Society Cymru, Guide Dogs Cymru. What I'd really like to see is the opportunity for local authorities across the whole of the UK to make sure that all of the companies that they contract with that have outward-facing staff, they're disability trained, because so often a council might have a taxi firm that they contract with to take children to school, and they don't quite have the, not necessarily the training, but the understanding, or the, you know, the understanding of the issues and, you know, just how, say, changing the driver on a daily basis for a child with autism can be a really big impact. So yes, I'd really like to draw more light on that issue. And that's not just Swansea, that's UK-wide. I think, you know, all local authorities could learn something there.
I also know there was an incident before where the taxi driver didn't actually know how to use the ramps, the setting up the ramps, and that put that person...
Oh, yeah.
Just, like you said, they need that understanding, the knowledge, and I agree with you there.
It's a small thing, but it makes a big difference to people's lives. It's things that we take for granted, and we're lucky enough to be able to take for granted, but it's those little things that really make the difference.
What about regarding homelessness and that, then?
Yeah, one of the things that we campaigned on during the Welsh Assembly elections and that I'm very passionate about is that we need to bring old houses back into use. It's all well and good when we talk about bringing homes into use and building more houses. Yes, we need more houses in the right places. But what we also need to do is use those old buildings that have been left to be ignored, or that aren't necessarily in exactly the right places anymore, but they have a use. Yeah. We need to make sure that we bring those back into use as well.
Is that for residential or commercial?
For residential, I think, is important.
But
I think
it's
you need
to get a mortgage, isn't it? All the mortgage help seems to be for new builds and all the rest of it. You've got to tick all the right boxes. Yeah.
Well, you say that, but actually Help to Buy in England was available for old houses and new houses.
What about in Wales?
Well, Welsh Government, Labour, they decided that it would only... Well, it's true. They decided it would only be available for new build houses. So you can't have the opportunity to buy an older house. But, you know, I met with The Wallich, which is a charity just based in Wales that work with local authorities and other homeless groups around the whole of Wales. They're doing a fantastic job and you know, that groups like that need to be supported as well.
Fairly briefly, the suggestion is among people that they feel they're going to vote for Theresa May, some people, for a strong and stable government. And yet, at the same time, they're very concerned about the perceived heartlessness and really ruthlessness of the Conservative stance.
In what context? About what?
Well, every context, really.
I think you have to take the individual. You have to look at what individuals are going to be standing up for. I'd like to think that I've shown that, you know, there's more to than just talking about Brexit, I'd like to think I've shown today. There are important local issues that people need championed and need standing up for, and I think that I can be that voice.
But there are very real reservations about Conservative government and about the heartlessness and ruthlessness, possibly.
What examples?
Well, I think particularly in Wales, we have a long history of not being too happy when there's a Conservative government. And they can be rather harsh and not empathetic. I mean, that's the perception among so many people.
Well, it's interesting that, you know, the opinion polls, and they are only polls, suggest that the Conservatives could top the polls in Wales for the first time.
That's so this strong, stable government bit, isn't it?
But arguably, Wales doesn't see us that way if the majority of people are considering that. But there are only polls and we need to keep working hard, of course.
I must state that there are other candidates also. And the deadline for submitting candidates for the general election is today, May the 11th. And as soon as they will be finalised, we will bring them all to you on BayTV.
Watch this space, yes.
Thank you. After the break, we'll be accompanied with OJ Lewis.
See you then.
Welcome back to Today on Bay TV. I'm Liz Cairns and this is Gaynor Morgan, and OJ Lewis has joined us.
And you opened the show in style. We're really blown away by that. So where can people see you next?
Well, I'm playing at Zinco Lounge this evening. It's the first open mic night they're doing there, so I'm playing there. Hopefully I'm going to be doing JC's.
And that's in Swansea, yeah?
Yeah, it's in Swansea, sorry, yeah. And JC's open mic night in Student Union in Swansea Uni, I do every Tuesday night as well. I play a bit. I played on Wine Street. I played down the bucket list on Wine Street and stuff, hopefully. I'm part of the Live Music Society and I'm on the committee now. I got elected last night, so hopefully I'm going to try and get a bit more live music started from Swansea around Swansea, you know, from the university's sort of point of view.
Oh, brilliant.
You've got a wonderfully deep voice. I was really struck. You're quite a slight little lad, aren't you?
Yeah.
So where's that come from?
I don't know, you know. I just smoking, really. You know, that's what it is.
Don't say that.
That does not help, by the way.
I'm not allowed to say that. No. But now I've given up. Don't worry about it. No, it's just, I mean, just being in uni, I mean, you're up late at night, you know. Yeah. Just,
oh, it's a hard life.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I really feel for you.
You don't get a lot of rest. It's a lot of stress. It just wears you all down, you know.
Have you always had that gravelly type voice then?
Yeah.
So you've had singing lessons as well, haven't you?
Yeah, I started singing lessons when I was in year 7. And I had them all the way through into year 13. Well, I did my grade 8 exam then. I passed grade 8 when I was 17 years old. And I've always been, I always hated it, because when I was forced to be in choirs and stuff in school, and I was always given the bass part, and the bass part is the most horrible part you can possibly do, because it's nothing to do. When you know a song, and you know a song, the bass part's never the main part of the song, and you've just got to relearn the whole song, and you've just got to, I just sit by somebody who knows what they're doing and try and follow along with them, you know.
So have you come from a musical family?
Yeah, my dad, so he started playing guitar when he was about 14, 15 years old. He got his first guitar that I started playing on as well. He got his first guitar from his uncle. And he went on to be a bassist in a country band that toured the UK a little bit, but then he sort of quit that as soon as he had a family and stuff like that. But me and my brother and sister, we all have a grade 6, 7, 8 in our singing. And we all play guitar, piano, and bass, and drums, and stuff like that, you know, as well.
It's quite rowdy when you get home.
It's quite fun, you know, because I mean, we don't have any neighbours for 2 miles.
Brilliant.
And we're up in Mid-Wales, aren't you?
Yeah.
Just as well, probably.
And we've put a studio in our outbuilding out there, so we've got a full PA set up out there and everything, and you can just absolutely turn up to 11 and just absolutely smash out a good song, you know.
Some very happy sheep in the field.
So have you recorded anything that's going to be released soon?
Yeah, hopefully. I'm going to get an EP out soon. I'm recording it. I've recorded about 3 or 4 songs so far. I'm thinking of calling the EP a Blues Odyssey. Because all it is it's just blues. It's just like, I don't know, it's about half an hour of blues music. You know?
Is that where you get your inspiration?
Yeah, like B.B. King, Howlin' Wolf, John Lee Hooker, Muddy Waters, Chuck Berry, Elvis, and you know, all that sort of. That's who I listen to. But I remember my biggest inspiration is Mick Jagger. You know, I remember he was a person that got me into music. Listening to Sympathy for the Devil when I was about 14 years old. That's when I really, really got into music. You know, I just typed into YouTube Sympathy for the Devil, and I came up with the recommendations. I was clicking on Honky Tonk Women, Brown Sugar, everything else. For one summer, I listened to about 3 Stones songs on repeat on my iPod every night. I was going through these 3 songs every night until I fell asleep, you know.
So you're planning to go sing, are you planning to go independent, or are you hoping to be signed?
I hope to be signed, you know. I'm hoping this summer to get enough money together to go down to London and try and get myself down in the circuit down there, hopefully, and so. Yeah. And hopefully I'll be able to, I mean, I'll be happy playing in front of anybody that'll listen to me, really. But no, I mean, I do want to go sort of like professional with it, you know, so I would like to.
I suppose that's signed. Quite a big investment, isn't it? There's the cost of accommodation and all the rest of it.
Yeah, and the actual musical instruments to start with. That's quite a heavy investment up front, you know. So my first guitar ever cost, I think it was 50 quid. But this one I just played now on TV just now was substantially more than that. But I mean, it's paid for itself now, thankfully. Mm. But straight up, that was a hit in the student loan, you know.
Is there anywhere where you'd really love to play that you haven't yet?
Oh, man. I don't know. I mean, I'm happy with where I've played.
Yeah.
I mean, the one place I really want to play again is... last summer, I was at Mid Wales Rhythm and Blues Club.
Yeah.
In Rheda, in Mid Wales. And this guy came over from America called Doug McLeod. And he was the guy that really, really sort of re-sparked my interest in music. Yeah. So I played there before he went there. But now I've got so much better at guitar. Because I've only been playing properly for the last, I don't know, 12 months on guitar.
Oh,
I've only
been
playing properly, you know. But I've been, you know, I'd love to go back there and sort of wear... I sort of play there again and show how much I've progressed in that 12-month space from when I heard him and sort of re-sparked that interest in blues and rock and roll, and then to be able to go back there would be pretty nice because it's a really nice intimate venue, you know. Yeah. You've got a real nice sort of.
So have a good busy summer coming up.
Oh no!
You will after this.
I just finished my last assignment on Tuesday. I've got one exam on the 5th of June, and then after that, I'm nothing. That's all. I'm trying to sort myself out. Something like going
down. Is
this
your finals?
No, I'm in second. I've just finished second year now.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, are you hoping to make a full-time career in music, or will you use your degree?
No, I hope to make a full-time. My plan is when I finish university next year, I'm going to sort of. You know, buy my dad's van, put a mattress in the back of it, and sort of go around the UK and try and find places to play.
Musician's dream.
I was going to say,
young person.
And if that doesn't work out for me or whatever, I'm going to go back and do my PGC and hopefully become a history teacher or something like that. You know.
I'm looking forward to hearing you again.
To everyone.
I am. Yeah, definitely.
Thank you
so much.
It's all right. Thank you very much.
And we're going to hear you again now. Thank you to all our guests today and for all our viewers watching us, especially those who have tuned in for our Talking Pictures afternoon matinee, coming up next on B.
And today it's the 1957 musical After the Ball, starring Pat Kirkwood.
And with that, take it away, OJ Lewis.
If you see my little red rooster, won't you please drive him home? I said, if you see my little red rooster, baby, won't you please drive him home? some peace in my farmyard since my little red rooster's been gone.